If you followed along in all the tutorials on this channel, you are beginning to have a good understanding of how the GrandMA3 software works, and you are on your way of being a GrandMA3 programmer. Now I think it's time to look at some different GrandMA3 programming techniques. In this episode, I'll show you how you can program GrandMA3 sequences and how you can manipulate the cues to do quite amazing things. I'll show you a lot of different techniques that can help you when you start making your own GrandMA3 shows, so be sure to watch the video all the way to the end so you don't miss any shortcuts or something you didn't know you needed or something you didn't know the GrandMA3 could do. So let's get into it. Let's start by making two simple cues. Let's first of all take all our vipers and we turn them on. We put them in a position like this. We give them a color. Then we take all our auras, we do the same thing, turn them on, give them a position and give them a color like this. And then we take all our dimmers, just turn them on. So this is basically cue number one. So let's store this into a sequence, an empty sequence here. Let's label the sequence to our master cue list, maybe a master sequence, we could call it like this. As you can see it over here, it's empty, but as soon as I click it, you can see what's going on. Let's relabel the first cue to start cue like this. And then we need to assign it to a fader up here. So we say assign, we take the sequence and we assign it to fader number 201. As you remember, maybe if you've seen followed along the tutorial series, you can manipulate the faders up here. And what we need to do is go into the section up here and just add this section because I need a go minus button as well. Right now we have a go plus down here, so we can go forward in our cue list. We need to be able to go backwards as well. So let's close this down. Let's clear the programmer and let's go into cue number one like this. Now we need to be able to see the changes, we need to make cue number two. So let's take all our vipers, make them all white and make them go into the downstate center position. Then we can take all our dimmers and we can turn them off and we can store this into cue number two. So create second cue. Let's call this DS center. There we go. So if we clear the programmer again and we go from, we are in cue number one, we go to cue number two, everything happens, but it happens really, really fast and we don't want that. So we go into the fade option here and we set it to, let's say 5 seconds. There we go. And then we go back to cue number one again. And when we go into cue number two, it's going to nicely fade from one cue to the next in 5 seconds. So that's really cool. And as you can see here, all the dimmers turned off and everything moved and the vipers changed color to white over 5 seconds. But maybe we want everything turning off to do that faster. And there's a really, really easy way to do that. You can simply right click this one and you can say, fade in is 5 seconds, and you can use the dash here and say fade out is 1 second. And if you say please here and you go back again, this is cue number one. All our dimmers up here should turn off now in 1 second, and everything else should fade in 5 seconds. So we say go, and as you can see, they turned off a lot faster than the rest of the movement here. So that's a really, really easy way to do fade in and fade out times. You find yourself using that a lot if you are doing theater maybe, or even rock concert as well. This is a really easy way to do it. You can do it individually as well. And right now we are in cue number two. You could basically say edit, enter. That's always going to open up the cue you're in on the selected cue list. If you have a lot of cue lists, a lot of sequences, it's going to select whatever is selected up here. So that's another way of doing it. You can do it individually. You can say all dimmers. You can go into the fade option here and you can set a different time in here and update your cue. It's going to do exactly the same thing and it's going to help you if you need to have many different out times in one single cue. Well, let's clear this and maybe exit out of the editor and say, okay, this is cue number two. Let's turn off all our vipers because we need to set them up with a gobo. So let's turn them off and store that in cue number three here. And we can say viper off. And let's turn them back on again and maybe put in a gobo. And then let's store that in cue number four. There we go. And we can say gobo on. Let's work with wait times. Right now, all the Vipers are turning off. If we clear the programmer and we go into this one, it's going to happen instantly. We don't want that. So let's set a fade time of 2 seconds and we go back. And now they're going to fade out in 2 seconds. Very nice. But now when I go into the next cue, they're going to turn on again in 0 seconds and all the gobos are probably going to go through the fixture. You can see that if we go back, you can see that again. You see all the gobos moving. We don't want to see the gobos moving, so we need to give it some sort of wait time. So we need, so if the dimmer waits maybe half a second to come up, the fixture needs the time to set up the gobos behind the scenes. So if we say gobo on here and we say edit enter or edit please, we go into our Vipers, we go into our dimmer here and we go into the delay option. And we can simply set a delay of maybe half a second, like this. And we need to update our cue list. There we go. Clear the programmer. We go back one cue. So in our previous cue, we had all the Vipers on into the downstage center position. The next cue turned all the Vipers off. And now we need to turn them all on again, but without seeing the gobo action. And we did that by delaying the dimmer only about half a second. So when I press go, it's going to come up nice and easy instead of coming up really, really fast. And maybe we need to set a fade in time as well. Let's say we set a 2 second fade time as well. Now we are in cue number 3 and we need to go to cue number 3 and you can see, sorry, cue number 4. And you can see it turns on really nicely. Let's just do it again. Right now they are off. We go and they cue up the gobo and then it turns on. So we just simply delay it a little bit. And that is also very, very helpful. You'll find yourself doing that when you are dealing with gobos. And you are actually doing it as well when you're dealing with media servers. Because sometimes a media server needs a few milliseconds to queue up the clip you have on the server. So this is going to help you a lot to do some split timings. As you can see, working with GrandMA3 Cues is simple. But there's a lot more in this episode. So make sure you stick around for the last part. And if you enjoy this video and find it useful, be sure to give it a like. Liking videos is a great and free way to support any YouTube channel, and it sends a signal to YouTube to show the video to more people. And please leave a comment below if you have anything on your mind. I mean, it's always nice to hear from you. Getting some kind of response makes it a lot more fun to make these videos. And if you're interested in GrandMA3 hardware, I have some links in the description for all kinds of different pieces of GrandMA3 hardware. A small disclaimer, though, is the links in the description are all affiliate links. That means if you decide to purchase some of the products, I will receive a small commission on the sale. But let's continue. So let's see what else we can do. Let's build a sequence right next to the other one where we take all the color out of the Vipers. We take all the Vipers, we take the color out, or we just choose the open white color. We store this into a separate sequence. Let's label it white. There we go. And we select it and we can see this sequence over here. So if we clear the programmer and we maybe assign this sequence on a fader up here, we go into the options here and we add the next row of buttons here and we make the top button an off button. Then I can go this sequence and I can turn it off again. That's fine. Everything turns on in white. That's cool. But let's maybe go into the cue here. Maybe we should just label it white as well. There we go. So we clear this one. Let's say we need to split the time of this cue. So let's go into our cue here. Let's say edit, please. That loads everything into the programmer. Let's take all our Vipers and go into the color. And sorry, we need to go into the color, but we need a delay time here. We set it to 0 through 1 second, please. And now we need to update this cue. And it's been updated and let's clear out. So right now, if we turn it off on the off button up here and I go the cue, you can see it comes in as a split time between 0 and 1 second. And that is really cool. So let's make a new cue here where we take all our Vipers again and put it back to the magenta color and we store this in a second cue and we do exactly the same thing. We can go back to magenta right here. And we do the same thing. We go into the cue like this. We say edit, please. And we do the same thing on the delay. We set it from 0 through 1 second. And we update the cue like this. And we clear the programmer once again. So in when I go into cue number one, it's going to do all the white in. And when I go into cue number two, it's going to take it out again. And here comes the fun part. We can actually make it go directly to the next cue. So instead of this down here being a go button, we can right click and set a time for it, or we can make it a follow cue. Let's just make it a follow cue so that you can see what happens. I go into cue number one, they turn on, and it follows right next into cue number two. So let's see it again, and it takes it all the way out. So the follow cue follows as soon as the previous cue is complete. So if I change this into a timed cue, for instance, I can set a trigger time of maybe 0.6 seconds. Then it's going to follow actually before this one is done. And it actually makes some kind of cool effect. So if I off it again and I go into the cue, when you see what's happening, it's going to take it out again. So you now made some kind of actually really cool effect without using the phaser engine at all. Let's just see it again. It goes into white and it takes it back to magenta. So that's a really, really cool effect. Doing this with split times is actually very, very, very cool. So if you are in your master cue list and you needed to trigger the cue list next to it, you can actually use the command line or use a command line command in the cue list. So let's just clear everything out here. And let's just store an empty queue into this one. This is queue number 5 and there's nothing in it. And let's go down to the command section down here. We have queue number 5 and we select it and we say go sequence 2. If I go into my master queue list now and I press go, I'm in queue number 2. We go into queue number 3. Let's just go into queue number 4. And as you can see here, I have a queue with nothing in it, but it's going to go sequence number 2, which is this one. And see what happens when I press go on this one. You saw that? That's really, really cool. So you can use this bump effect. You can simply push it, or you can assign it to another queue or sequence or whatever, and you can remote trigger it from there. GrandMA3 programming is cool, and remember that we are still in the very early stages of the software, as I explained in the last tutorial as well. I'm sure that GrandMA3 software will evolve a lot over the next few years, just like the early days of the GrandMA2 software. Be sure to give this video a like so you can spread it out to more people, and subscribe to the channel if you don't want to miss any future episodes. Or you can start the GrandMA3 tutorial playlist and you can start from episode 1. And I promise that you will know what it's all about when you have seen all the episodes so far. I try to release one video per week, so please come back if you want to continue learning GrandMA3 programming. And if you are on the journey of learning GrandMA3 programming as a beginner, I highly suggest that you watch this next video. In this video, I will show you some other cool features of the GrandMA3 software. I hope to see you on the channel again in the future, and until then, happy programming!